Good morning, students. So how are you? All are fine? Yeah, good. So say your prayer. Yeah, thank you. நான் ஒரு நல்லாசிரியர், நான் உங்களுக்கு தாயாகவும் தந்தையாகவும் இருந்து முறையாக அன்போடு கல்வியை போதிப்பேன். நான் ஒரு நல்லாசிரியர், நான் உங்களுக்கு தாயாகவும் தந்தையாகவும் இருந்து முறையாக அன்போடு கல்வியை போதிப்பேன். நான் ஒரு நல்லாசிரியர், நான் உங்களுக்கு தாயாகவும் தந்தையாகவும் இருந்து முறையாக அன்போடு கல்வியை போதிப்பேன். ஓகே ஸ்டூடெண்ட்ஸ், டேக் யுவர் சோசியல் சயின்ஸ் புக் அண்ட் கம் டு பேஜ் நம்பர் 116. ஸோ வி ஆர் டிஸ்கஸிங் அபவுட் த முகல்ஸ் இன் இந்தியா. So the period of Mughals is a very important period in the history of India. So we discussed about the great Mughal rulers of India in our previous classes. So today we will discuss about the Mughal administration, then art and architecture. So first we will discuss about the Mughal administration. So first central administration, provincial administration, local administration, then their army, then the Mansabdari system, then land revenue system. And also we've discussed about the religious policy of the Mughals, and finally about art and architecture. So if we tell about any Mughal ruler name, means suddenly some of their architectural work comes in our mind. Like if you say Shah Jahan, suddenly we remember about his architecture skill. So that is about Taj Mahal, then Red Fort, etc. So they gave importance to architecture also. So today's class we will discuss about their administration. Their way of administration. So how they rule the country. So how they run the government. Then finally about art and architecture. Kima? So in our previous class, what we discussed? We discussed about the great Mughals. So the last three great Mughals. So first Jahangir, then Shah Jahan, then finally about Aurangzeb. So Jahangir, so his original name was Prince Salim. So he was son of Akbar. But he was interested in art and painting and gardens and flowers. So that rather than running the government. So Jahangir's wife. So who was Jahangir's wife? So Mehrunnisa, also famously called as Noor Jahan. So she enjoyed the real power. So Jahangir, so he ordered the execution of Sikh leader. So who was he? Guru Arjun Singh. So after him only the relationship between the Mughals and Sikh went on confrontation. As a result of Jahangir's orders of execution of a Sikh leader Guru Arjun Singh, the relationship between the Mughals and the Sikhs get affected. During the period of Jahangir only, Damas Rao, a representative of King James I of England, established the first factory in Surat. Damas Rao, a representative of King James I of England, got permission from Jahangir, and after that only the English established their first factory at Surat. So we have discussed this. Then Shah Jahan. Jahangir was succeeded by his son Shah Jahan. So Shah Jahan was called as, his original name was Prince Khurram. Shah Jahan means king of the world. So he extended his empire towards Deccan region. But he was also intolerant towards other religions than Islam. During his period, the Mughal architecture skill went beyond its limit. He gave much importance to architecture. But after Shah Jahan, he was succeeded by his son Aurangzeb. Aurangzeb emerged successful after killing his three brothers Dara, Shuja and Murad. We have discussed that. Then Aurangzeb, how he ruled the country. He assumed the title Alamgir. Alamgir means the conqueror of the world. He was the last great ruler of Mughals. He was not a lover of art like his grandfather Jahangir, or architecture like his father Shah Jahan. His entire period went on extending his empire. During the period of Aurangzeb, the whole of Indian subcontinent was occupied by Aurangzeb. He extended his empire up to the south of India. He extended up to Madurai. He was a strong ruler. Because of his religious policy, he have not a good relationship with the Rajput and Marathas. During his period only, the Maratha leader, Shivaji, she emerged a powerful person. We discussed about Aurangzeb finally. By the end of Aurangzeb rule, the British had strongly established their trade center at Madras, Calcutta and Bombay, and the French had their ట్రేడ్ సెంటర్ ఇన్ పాండిచేరి. ఓకేవా? సో టుడే వి విల్ మూవ్ టు ద ముగల్ అడ్మినిస్ట్రేషన్. సో ప్రీవియస్ క్లాస్ వి డిస్కస్డ్ అబౌట్ ద గ్రేట్ ముగల్స్. సో హూ ఆర్ ది సిక్స్ గ్రేట్ ముగల్స్? యా, ఫస్ట్ బాబర్, దెన్ హుమాయూన్, దెన్ అక్బర్, దెన్ జహాంగీర్, షాజహాన్, ఔరంగజేబ్. ఓకేవా? సో ఫస్ట్ ద సెంట్రల్ అడ్మినిస్ట్రేషన్. సో ద ముగల్స్ ప్రొవైడెడ్ ఏ స్టేబుల్ అడ్మినిస్ట్రేషన్ ఇన్ లార్జర్ పార్ట్ ఆఫ్ ఇండియా. సో సెంట్రల్ అడ్మినిస్ట్రేషన్ మీన్స్ సో లైక్ ద సెంట్రల్ గవర్నమెంట్. సో ద ముగల్స్ ప్రొవైడెడ్ ఏ స్టేబుల్ అడ్మినిస్ట్రేషన్ ఇన్ లార్జర్ పార్ట్స్ ఆఫ్ ఇండియా. ద ఎంపరర్, సో ద కింగ్, హీ వాస్ ది సుప్రీం హెడ్ ఆఫ్ ది ముగల్ అడ్మినిస్ట్రేటివ్ సిస్టమ్. సో నౌ లైక్ ది ప్రైమ్ మినిస్టర్, సో ప్రైమ్ మినిస్టర్ ది సుప్రీం హెడ్ నో లైక్ దట్. సో డ్యూరింగ్ ద ముగల్ పీరియడ్ ద ఎంపరర్ వాస్ ది సుప్రీం హెడ్ ఆఫ్ ది ముగల్ అడ్మినిస్ట్రేటివ్ సిస్టమ్. సో హీ వాస్ ది లా మేకర్. సో హీ వాస్ ది లా మేకర్. దెన్ హీ వాస్ ది చీఫ్ ఎగ్జిక్యూటివ్, దెన్ ది కమాండర్ ఇన్ చీఫ్ ఆఫ్ ది ఆర్మీ అండ్ ద ఫైనల్ డిస్పెన్సర్ ఆఫ్ ది జస్టిస్. సో హీ వాస్ ది లా మేకర్. సో హీ క్యాన్ క్రియేట్ లా, హీ క్యాన్ క్యాన్సల్ ఇయర్ లా. దెన్ హీ ఈస్ ది చీఫ్ ఎగ్జిక్యూటివ్. సో బట్ నౌ డేస్ సో దీస్ ఆర్ గివన్ టు సెపరేట్ పర్సన్స్. సో యాజ్ ఇన్ డెమోక్రసీ, సో దర్ ఈస్ ఏ సెపరేట్ లా మినిస్టర్, దెన్ ఎగ్జిక్యూటివ్ ఆఫీసర్స్ ఆర్ దర్, దెన్ దర్ ఈస్ ఎ సెపరేట్ కమాండర్ ఇన్ చీఫ్ ఆఫ్ ది ఆర్మీ. బట్ డ్యూరింగ్ ద ముగల్ అడ్మినిస్ట్రేషన్ సో ద కింగ్, సో ద ఎంపరర్, సో హీ వాస్ ది లా మేకర్, దెన్ హీ వాస్ ది చీఫ్ ఎగ్జిక్యూటివ్, దెన్ హీ వాస్ ది కమాండర్ ఇన్ చీఫ్ ఆఫ్ ది ఆర్మీ, దెన్ ఫైనలీ హీ ఈస్ ది ఫైనల్ డిస్పెన్సర్. సో డిస్పెన్సర్ మీన్స్ టు గివ్ ఆర్ ప్రొవైడ్ పీపుల్ విత్ సంథింగ్. సో హీ వాస్ ది ఫైనల్ అడ్వైజర్, సో ఫైనల్ ప్రొవైడర్ ఆఫ్ జస్టిస్. సో in his administration he was assisted by a council of ministers. So the emperor, so the Mughal emperor was assisted, helped by a council of ministers. So the most important officials were the Wagil, so that is prime minister. So the most important officials were the Wagil, that is prime minister, and Wazir or Diwan. So Diwan, so he is in charge of the revenue and expenditure. So revenue expenditure, that is income and expenditure. So the council of ministers so help the emperor in the administrative function. So the most important officials were the Wagil, so that is the prime minister. So the prime minister, then Wazir or Diwan. Wagil, prime minister, then Wazir or Diwan. So he is in charge of the revenue and expenditure. Then Mirbakshi was in charge of the army. So Mirbakshi, so but the chief commander was the emperor. Apart from that, there are some officers. So the officer was called as Mirbakshi. So he was in charge of the army. Then Mir Saman looked after the royal household. So royal household means so the royal family. So the Mir Saman looked after the so the houses of royal family. Then the Quasi was the chief judge. So the Quasi was the chief judge. But the final dispenser of justice was the emperor. Then Sadur Us Sudur was the minister of enforcing Islamic law. So the Mughals ruled the kingdom based on the Islamic law. So the Islam, so the religion, so they have their some religious policy, so they have some rules and regulations. So the Mughals ruled based on such principles, so based on such law, so that is called as Sharia. So the Ghazi was the chief judge, then Sadr Us Sudr was the minister for enforcing. So for enforcing Islamic law, that is he put the Islamic law, so the Sharia, into effect. So the central administration, the Mughals provided a stable administration in larger part of India. The emperor was the supreme head of the Mughal administrative system. He was the lawmaker, the chief executive, the commander in chief of the army, and the final dispenser of justice. So he was assisted by a council of ministers. The most important officials were called the Wagil, the prime minister, then Wazir or Diwan, in charge of the revenue and expenditure, Mir Bakshi, so in charge of the army, Mir Saman, so who looked after the royal household, then Quasi, the chief judge, finally Sadr Us Sudr, so the minister for enforcing the Islamic law, so called as Sharia. Then provincial administration, so provinces. So the empire was divided into several subhas, so that is provinces. So the empire was divided into several subhas. So like, so now India, the whole country is divided into number of states now. So like that, so initially the Mughal kingdom was divided into several subhas, so called as provinces. So each subha was under the control of an officer called as subedar. So the empire was divided into several provinces, that is called as subhas. So each subha was under the control of an officer called as subedar. So the subhas were further divided into districts called as sarkar. So the subhas were further divided into districts. So districts were called as sarkars. Then further, so the sarkars were subdivided into parganas. So the sarkars were further subdivided into parganas. So like the talukas nowadays. Then a group of villages formed a pargana. So a group of villages formed a pargana. So we can simply say, so in reverse order we can say group of villages formed pargana. Group of pargana formed the sarkars. So group of sarkars formed the subhas. Then the subhas combined to form the whole kingdom. So the empire was divided into several subhas. Then each subha was under the control of a subedar. Then subhas were further divided into sarkars. Sarkar further divided into parganas. Then parganas divided into a village, a group of village. The local administration. So apart from the provincial administration, we have local. So that is towns and cities. So the towns and cities were administered by the kotwals. So the towns and cities were administered by the officers called as kotwals. So the kotwals maintained law and order. So like the police nowadays. So kotwals maintained the law and order. Then the administration of village was left in the hands of local village panchayat. So the towns and cities were administered by the kotwals, while the village was administered by the local village panchayat. So the local village panchayat. So the informal institution of justice in village. So the informal. So they provide law. So they provide justice just through an informal manner only. So there is no written law. So then the panchayatars. So that is the jury. So dispensary justice. So the panchayatars. So they dispensed justice. So the local administration, the towns and cities were administered by the kotwals, and they maintained the law and order. Then the administration of village was left in the hands of local village panchayat, informal institution of justice in village. The panchayatars dispensed justice. Then the army. So the Mughal, so they ruled the major part of India. So their army was powerful. So how they maintained the army? So what was in the Mughal army? The Mughal army comprised infantry. So infantry means so soldiers who fight on foot. So infantry. So in Tamil we can say the Kalat Padai. Then cavalry. The soldiers fight on horse. So the soldiers fight on horse. That is horse force. The Kudarai Padai. Then war elephant. Then and artillery. So large heavy gun moved on wheel. So the Mughal army comprised of infantry, that is the soldiers who fight on foot, then cavalry, the soldiers who fight on horse, then war elephant, then artillery. So the large heavy guns moved on wheel. Because so Babur, so he only introduced the gunpowder in India. So Babur was the first ruler to introduce gunpowder in India. So after that, so many rulers began to use the gunpowder. So before that, just they fight with each other only with the help of weapons made by hand. Then the emperor maintained a large number of trained and well-armed bodyguards and palace guards. So the emperor maintained a large number of trained and well-armed bodyguards. So who is a bodyguard? A person or a group of people whose job is to protect somebody. So bodyguard means a person or a group of people whose job is to protect somebody. Palace guards, a group of people whose job is to protect their palace. So the Mughal army comprised of infantry, cavalry, war elephant and artillery. And also the emperor, so maintained a large number of trained and well-armed bodyguards and palace guards. Then the Mansabdari system. So what is the Mansabdari system? So who introduced this? So Akbar. So the Akbar the Great, he introduced the Mansabdari system. So according to the system, the nobles, civil and military officials were combined to form one single service. So Akbar introduced the Mansabdari system. As per this system, the nobles, the civils and the military officials. So the common civil and the military officials were combined to form one single service. Everyone in the service was given a mansab. So mansab means a rank or a position. So Akbar introduced the Mansabdari system. So according to the system, the nobles, civils and military officials were combined to form one single service. So everyone in the service was given a mansab. So mansab means a position or a rank. A mansabdar was a holder of such a rank. So mansabdar means a position or a rank. So Mansabdar rank was dependent on Zat and Jawar. So Mansabdar rank. So how they gave the rank to the Mansabdar? It depends on Zat and Savatar. So Zat means it indicates one's status. So Zat means it indicates one's status. So Savar means the number of horses and horsemen he had to maintain. So Mansabdar rank was decided based on Zat and Savar. So Zat, it indicates one's status. Well, Savar means the number of horses and horsemen, so that should be maintained by a Mansabdar. His salary was fixed on the basis of number of soldiers each Mansabdar received, ranging from 10 to 10,000. So the salary of the Mansabdar is fixed on the basis of the number of soldiers each Mansabdar received. So a Mansabdar received the soldiers from 10 to 10,000. That means he had to maintain 10 to 10,000. So the lowest level Mansabdar had to maintain 10 soldiers, and a Mansabdar, so who rank top in position, had to maintain 10,000 soldiers. So 10,000 soldiers and also the horses. Okay, ma? So Akbar introduced the Mansabdari system. According to the system, the nobles, civil and military officials were compelled to form one single service. So everyone in the service was given a Mansab. So Mansab means a position or a rank. A Mansabdar was a holder of such rank. So Mansabdar means, so he is just a person who provides service. So his rank, so how the rank was given means, it is based on Zat and Savar. So Zat, it indicates one's status, while Savar, so the number of horses and horsemen he had to maintain. His salary was fixed on the basis of number of soldiers each Mansabdar received, so ranging from 10 to 10,000. The Mansabdars were paid high salary by the emperor. So the Mansabdars were paid high salary by the emperor. Before receiving the salary, a Mansabdar had to present his horsemen for inspection. So before receiving the salary, a Mansabdar had to present his horsemen for inspection, for checking. Their horses were branded to prevent theft. So the Mansabdar horses were branded. So they were given a separate mark. So each Mansabdar horse were given a separate mark, had to present his horsemen for inspection. So their horses were branded to prevent theft. So the emperor could not use, the emperor could use the troops maintained by a Mansabdar whenever he wished. So the rank of Mansabdar was not hereditary during Akbar's time, but after him it became a hereditary one. Then the land revenue administration. So we discussed about the central administration. So the emperor is the supreme head of the Mughal administrative system. He was assisted by a council of ministers. Then provincial administration. So how was the empire divided? So empire was divided into subhas. Then subhas was further divided into sargars. Then sargars to parganas. Then finally parganas divided as villages, that is gramas. Then the local administration. So the towns and cities were administered by the court walls, while the village was administered by the local village panchayat. Then the army. So the Mughal army comprised of infantry, cavalry, war elephant and artillery. So apart from that, the emperor maintained a well-armed and trained bodyguards and palace guards. Then we discussed about the Mansabdari system. Akbar introduced the Mansabdari system. Land revenue system was toned up during the reign of Akbar. So land revenue, it was also reaches its peak. So it became so very active. So it became very notable one during the reign of Akbar. So Raja Todarmal, the revenue minister of Akbar. So Raja Todarmal, so he was the revenue minister of Akbar, adapted and refined the system introduced by Sher Shah. So Raja Todarmal, the revenue minister of Akbar, adapted. So adapted means so followed and accepted. And he refined, and he refined the system introduced by Sher Shah. Todarmal's Japta system was put in place in north and northwest provinces. So Todarmal's Japta system was put in place in north and northwestern provinces. So what is the Japta system? So according to the system, after a survey, lands were classified according to the nature and fertility of the soil. So as per the Japta system, a survey was conducted. So what type of survey? So the land was classified according to the nature and fertility of the soil. So the share of the state was fixed at 1/3 of the average produce for 10 years. So the share of the state, so the share of the land, so to the state, was fixed at 1/3 of the average produced for 10 years. Yeah. So during the reign of Shah Jahan, the Zabt or Zabti system was extended to the Deccan provinces. So that is to central and southern India. Yeah, so to central India. Yeah, so during the reign of Shah Jahan, the Zabt or Zabti system was extended to the Deccan provinces. Yeah, so the land revenue system. So the land revenue system was toned up, was increased. Yeah, so the land revenue administration was increased during the reign of Akbar. Raja Todarmal, the revenue minister of Akbar, adopted and refined the system. So the land revenue system introduced by Sher Shah. So who was Sher Shah? So the founder of Shur dynasty. So who defeated Humayun? So in the beginning of this lesson, we have discussed about him. So Todarmal's Zabt system was put in place in north and northwest provinces. According to the system, after a survey, lands were classified according to the nature and fertility of the soil. So the share of the state was fixed at 1/3 of the average produced for 10 years. So during the period of Shah Jahan, the Zabt or Zabti system was extended to the Deccan provinces also. Then the Mughal emperors enforced the old Iqtar system, renaming it Jagir. Yeah, so the Mughal emperors enforced the old Iqtar system. So Iqtar system, they introduced by the Delhi Sultanate. Yeah, so the Mughal emperors enforced the old Iqtar system, renaming it as Jagir. Yeah, it is a land tenure system developed during the period of Delhi Sultanate. Yeah, so the land tenure system introduced by the Delhi Sultanate was called as Iqtar system. Yeah, the Mughal emperors renamed it as Jagir. Yeah. Under the system, the collection of the revenue of an area. Yes, under the system, the collection of then revenue. So that is the tax of an area, and the power of governing it were bestowed upon a military or civil official, now named as Jagirdar. Yeah, so the Mughal emperors enforced the old Iqtar system. That is the collection of revenue. Yeah, so the emperor. So they put a tax. So they want to collect revenue. So how they collect revenue? So they appoint some officers. Yeah, so during the Delhi Sultanate period, it was called as Iqtar system. Yeah, but the Mughals, yes, renamed it as Jagir system. Yeah, so under the system, the collection of the revenue of an area and the power of governing the area were given to the military or civil official, and they were named as Jagirdar. Yeah, so under the system, the collection of the revenue of an area and the power of governing the area was given to the officers called as Jagirdar. Yeah. Every Mansabdar was a Jagirdar if he was not paid in cash. Yeah. So you know, so Mansabdar, so he received high salary. Yeah. But if he does not receive salary as in cash means, then he is considered as Jagirdar. Yeah. So the Mansabdar, he received salary from the king. Yeah. So from the emperor. Yeah. But when the Mansabdar, yeah, so if he did not receive paid in cash means, then he is acted as a Jagirdar. Yeah. So the Jagirdar collected the revenue through his officials. Yeah. So the Jagirdar collected the revenue, collect the tax through his own officials. Yeah. The Amal Guzar. So the Amal Guzar, the revenue collector of the district, was assisted by subordinate officers like the Potdar, Kunango, the Patwari, and Mukadams. Yeah. So the Amal Guzar, the revenue collector of the district, was helped by the subordinate officers like the Potdar, Chunango, the Patwari, and Mukadams. Yeah, so the Mughal emperors enforced the old Iqtar system, so called as Jagir. Yeah, so it was a land tenure system introduced by the Delhi Sultanate. Yes, under the system, the collection of revenue of an area and the power of governing it were given to the military or civil officers called as Jagirdar. Yeah, so the Jagirdar, so collect the revenue through his own officials. So those appointed to collect the revenue from the landholders were called as Jamindars. So those who appointed to collect revenue from the landholders were called as Jamindars. So Jamindars collected taxes and maintained law and order with the help of Mughal officials and soldiers. So the Jamindars, so they were appointed to collect the revenue from the landholders. Yeah. So the Jamindars collected taxes and they maintained law and order with the help of the Mughal officials and the soldiers. Yeah. So the local chieftains and little kings were also called as Jamindars. So sometimes the local chieftains and the little kings, the local kings, were called as the Jamindars. But the end of the 16th century, the Jamindars were conferred hereditary rights over their Jamin. But at the end of the 16th century, the Jamindars were conferred, the hereditary rights over their Jamin, so over their region. The Jamindar was empowered to maintain troops for the purpose of collecting revenue. They were given power to maintain troops, to maintain the soldiers for the purpose of collecting revenue. So the emperor granted lands to scholars, holy men, and religious institutions. So these lands called as suyurgal were tax-free. The granted to scholars, holy men, and religious institutions were called as suyurgal, and they were tax-free. So that is, there is no tax imposed on such granted lands. Revenue administration, so Raja Thodramal adopted and refined the system introduced by Shersha. So the Japta system, that is, the land were classified according to the nature and fertility of the soil. Then the share of the state was fixed to 1/3 of the average producer for 10 years. Then the Mughal, they enforced the old Ikta system, renamed it as Jagir, that is the collection of revenue. For that, they appointed the officers called as Jagirdar. Their duty is to collect the revenue. For them, there were several subordinate officers to collect the revenue. The Jamindars were appointed to collect the revenue from the landholders. The Jamindars, they collect taxes and maintain law and order with the help of Mughal officials and soldiers. But at the end of the 16th century, the Jamindars were conferred hereditary rights over their Jamin. So the Jamindar was empowered to maintain troops for the purpose of collecting revenue. Then the religious policy. So we discussed about the Mughal administration, central administration, provincial, local, army, then their manchab their system, then land revenue system. Then the religious policy. The Mughal emperors were the followers of Islam. Akbar was very liberal in his religious policy. So liberal means, so very open. So he was very free. Freedom. He gave freedom to other religious also. In Akbar's court, the Portuguese missionaries were great favorites. Those who went to spread the religion of Christianity. In Akbar's court, the Portuguese missionaries were great favorite. Akbar tried to include the good principles in all religions and formulated them into one single faith called as Deen Ilahi. Good principles from Hindu, good principles from Islam, good principles from Christianity. He tried to include all the good principles in all religions and formulated them into one single faith called as Deen Ilahi, that is divine faith. Jahangir and Shah Jahan also followed the policy of Akbar. But Aurangzeb, he rejected the liberal views of his predecessors, As we pointed out earlier, he reimposed the jizya and the pilgrim tax on the Hindus. Akbar, he was not like his grandfather or great-grandfather or like his father. He rejected their liberal views of religion. He reimposed the jizya and pilgrim tax on the Hindus. Jizya means, the tax that should be paid by the non-Muslims. Then pilgrim tax. Pilgrim means, we went on voyage. In the name of God, that is called as pilgrim tax. His intolerance towards other religion made him unpopular among the people. He was not tolerant toward other religion. It make him an unpopular person among the people. The Mughal emperors were the followers of Islam. Akbar was very liberal in his religious policy. In Akbar's court, the Portuguese missionaries were great favorite. Akbar tried to include the good principles in all religions and formulated them into one single faith called as Deen Ilahi. That is divine faith. Jahangir and Shah Jahan also followed the policy of Akbar. But they were not as like Akbar. Jahangir punished the Sikh leader. After that only, the relationship between the Mughals and Sikhs became worst. Yeah. But when compared to Aurangzeb, so Jahangir and Shah Jahan were somewhat best. Yeah. So Akbar was a very liberal person. But Aurangzeb, he rejected the liberal views of his ancestors, that is predecessors. Yeah. So he reimposed the jizya and the pilgrim tax on the Hindus. So his intolerance towards other religion made him unpopular among the people. Then the art and architecture. So Babur, so the founder of Mughal dynasty, introduced the Persian style of architecture to India by building many structures at Agra, Biana, Dholpur, Gwalior and Kyul. So that is Aligarh. Yeah. So Babur, so the founder of Mughal dynasty, introduced the Persian style of architecture to India by building many structures, so many architectural structures at Agra, Biana, Dholpur, Gwalior and Kyul. Yeah. But only a few of them existed today. Yeah. So he introduced the Persian style of architecture, but only a few of them existed today. Yeah. Humayun's palace in Delhi, Din-i-Pana. Yeah, so Humayun's palace in Delhi, called as Din-i-Pana, was probably destroyed by Sher Shah Sur, who built the Purana Kula in its place. Yeah, so Humayun's palace in Delhi was called as Din-i-Pana, but it was destroyed by Sher Shah. So he built the Purana Kula in its place. Yeah, the most prominent monument of Sher Shah's reign was his mausoleum built at Sasaram in Bihar. So the most prominent monument, prominent architect of Sher Shah's period was his mausoleum built at Sasaram in Bihar. So what is mausoleum? So a special building made to hold the dead body of an important person or the dead bodies of your family. You know, so a special building made to hold the dead body of an important person or the dead bodies of your family. You know, so the most prominent monument of Sher Shah's reign was his mausoleum built at Sasaram in Bihar. The Diwani Khas Diwani Am Panch Mahal, so that is premier structure in 5 stories, that is the building, so which have 5 floors in pyramidal structure. Yeah. Then Rang Mahal, Salim Chishti Tomb and Buland Darwaza were built during Akbar's time. Yeah. So the Diwani Khas Diwani Am Panch Mahal, so Panch, you know, in Hindi it means 5. So 5 Mahal, that means, so the building, so which is in pyramid shape, so have 5 floors. Yeah. Then Rang Mahal, then Salim Chishti's tomb and Buland Darwaza, so they were built during Akbar's time. Yeah. So Jahangir, so the son of Akbar, so completed Akbar's tomb at Sikandara, and the beautiful building containing the tomb of Itmat Uddawla, so the father of Noor Jahan at Agra. Yeah, so Jahangir completed Akbar's tomb at Sikandara, and the beautiful building containing the tomb of Itmat Uddawla. So Itmat Uddawla, so the tomb of the father of Noor Jahan. So who was Noor Jahan? Yeah, the wife of Jahangir. Yeah, so the tomb of Itmat Uddawla, so built at Agra. Shah Jahan, so he is very famous for his architecture work. Yeah, so actually his period is called as Golden Age of Mughals. Yeah, so Shah Jahan times witnessed the climax of the Mughals' splendor. Yeah, so the Shah Jahan period witnessed the climax of the Mughals' splendor. So splendor, so greatness. Yeah, the famous peacock throne covered with expensive jewels was made for the emperor to sit on. Yeah, so the emperor, so sit on a chair now, so sit on the throne now. You have noticed nowadays in many TV serials. Yeah. So for the throne, yeah, so he made an expensive peacock throne. So Shah Jahan made an expensive peacock throne, so which is covered with expensive jewels. Yeah. So then rose the world famous Taj Mahal by the side of Jumna River at Agra. So Jumna, the Yamuna River. Yeah. So first he made the peacock throne, so covered with expensive jewels, which is made for the emperor to sit on. Then he built the famous Taj Mahal, so for his wife Mumtaz, you know. So Taj Mahal was built by Shah Jahan in memory of his wife Mumtaz. You know, so it was built on the banks of river Yamuna at Agra. So besides Taj Mahal, he built the Modi Masjid, the Pearl Mosque at Agra. Yeah, so besides Taj, he built the Modi Masjid, that is the Pearl Mosque at Agra. So mosque, so the worship place of the Muslims. Yeah. Then the great Jama Masjid of Delhi. and Diwani Khas Diwani Am in his palace in Delhi. So besides Taj Mahal, he built the Modi Masjid, the Pearl Mosque at Agra, and also the Great Masjid of Delhi. And the Diwani Khas and Diwani Am in his palace at Delhi. So during Aurangzeb reign, architecture did not receive much patronage. So during Aurangzeb reign, architecture did not receive much support. The Bibi Ka Maqbara. So the Bibi Ka Maqbara, so which was built in Aurangabad. So it was a mausoleum. So mausoleum, a special building made to hold the dead body of an important person. So the Bibi Ka Maqbara in Aurangabad, a mausoleum built by his son Prince Azam Shah as a loving tribute to his mother in the late 17th century. So the Bibi Ka Maqbara in Aurangabad, so is a noteworthy one. So during the reign of Aurangzeb, so Aurangzeb, he did not give much importance to architecture. But his son, so Prince Azam Shah, so built a mausoleum, so called as Bibi Ka Maqbara in Aurangabad, a loving tribute to his mother in late 17th century. So it is somewhat noteworthy one. So what is this? Red Fort. So have you seen this picture before? So during Independence Day, you have noticed our Prime Minister, so hoisted the national flag and gave the speech to the people of India. So where he gave the speech? So in this palace only, in Red Fort. So who built Red Fort? Shah Jahan. So Red Fort, also called as Lal Qila in Delhi, was the residence of the Mughal emperors. So Red Fort, also called as Lal Qila in Delhi, was the residence of the Mughal emperors. It was constructed in 1639 by Emperor Shah Jahan at the palace of his fortified capital Shahjahanabad. So constructed in 1639 by Emperor Shah Jahan at the palace of his fortified capital Shahjahanabad. So Red Fort is named for its massive enclosing walls of red sandstone. So it is red in color. So that's why it was named as Red Fort. So the Red Fort is named for its massive enclosing walls of red sandstone. Okay, students. So we have completed the lesson. So the Mughals. So first we discussed about the founder of Mughal dynasty. So how the Mughal dynasty was established and the six great Mughals. Then in today's class, we discussed about the Mughal administration. So the central, provincial, local, army, mansabdar system, then land revenue system. Also, we discussed about the religious policy. So the religious faith introduced by Akbar was Deen Ilahi. Then we discussed about art and architecture. So Babur introduced the Persian style of architecture. Then the most important work, architecture work, was carried out by Akbar, then Shah Jahan. So Akbar, so he constructed Diwani Khas, Diwani Am, then Panch Mahal, Buland Darwaza, etc. So Jahangir completed Akbar's tomb at Sikandara and the beautiful building containing the tomb of Hikmat Ud-Dawla. Then Shah Jahan, so his period only witnessed the climax of Mughal splendor. So the famous Peacock Throne, then the Taj Mahal, then the Modi Masjid, the Great Jama Masjid, Diwani Khas, Diwani Am, Red Fort. So these were constructed during the reign of Shah Jahan. So now also, so the Red Fort and Taj Mahal, it stand unique in this architecture skill of Mughals. So but the last great Mughal, Aurangzeb, so he did not give much importance to architecture. But his son, Prince Azam Shah, so in loving tribute to his mother, he built a mausoleum called as Bibi Ka Maqbara in Aurangabad. So we have discussed these things in our today's class. Okay, so if you have any doubt in today's class, so please contact me. So take your book. Textbook reading. Page number 116. So the Mughal administration, central administration, provincial administration, local administration, and army. So read up to this. Then homework. So take page number 121. So for homework. 6th kilometer, give short answers. 3rd question, write a note on Mansabdari system. Write a note on Mansabdari system. Take page number 116 for answer. Mansabdari system. So heading, so the last heading, So first point, Akbar introduced the Mansabdari system. According to the system, the nobles, civil and military officials were combined to form one single service. So everyone in the service was given a Mansab, meaning a position or a rank. Then leave the next point. Then next point, Mansabdar was dependent on Jat and Savar. So answer for the third question. So write a short note on Mansabdar system. So write it in your homework note and read it well. So thank you. Have a nice day.